Stand by while NCLA cuts through the noise to signal abuse of administrative power. This is Administrative Static with Mark Chenoweth and John Vecchione.
Hello, welcome to Administrative Static. It's Mark and I are here, and for the third week in a row, as we lead up to the opening of the Supreme Court's term, a justice has spoken out about what they're not a political institution, and that their opinions aren't political, and that the reason people think otherwise is the press. This time, Justice Thomas was speaking at Notre Dame. And it's funny.
And just for those keeping score at home, the previous two were Justice Barrett and Justice Breyer. Is that correct?
That's correct. Justice Barrett at the University of Kentucky, and then Justice Breyer at Harvard. So what they all share in common, and Justice Thomas says, you know, his take on the Constitution is that it's to be read in light of the Declaration of Independence and the principles of Declaration of Independence, which is controversial in some circles. And he was speaking to Notre Dame about eternal principles. And then he was talking about how, you know, we don't do the things we do for this party or that party. And he means everybody. And I agree with him, but I think that in the present circumstances, I agree with Breyer, I've said, and I agree with Barrett. They don't think that they're doing X, Y, or Z for the Republican Party, but the parties now have real views, and those views are divergent on the matter of interpretation of statute and the creation of rights ex nihilo by the court. So that's Latin for out of nothing. But in any event, so I think that all of the justices that we've heard from of widely divergent experience, you've got the longest serving justices, you've got the newest justice. They're all concerned about this, Mark, and I think they should be. It's been shown that at least Democrats in America, their view of the Supreme Court has fallen off a cliff since that no stay was issued in that Texas case last month. And that just shows that for some people, they don't care about the work of the court. They care about outcomes. And if you care about outcomes, it's very hard to have a Supreme Court of the United States. The whole idea of it and the whole purpose of it is to apply the tools of the law to the statutes and the Constitution. And if you do that and you are against the popular will of the moment or one party's popular will, you're going to get opposition. Does that opposition take a legitimate approach, or does it take an illegitimate approach? And what I mean by that, Mark, is you may remember back in the 90s, I certainly do, that the Supreme Court came out with many interpretations of the civil rights laws that were more constrictive of plaintiffs' rights than the Democrats wanted. And what they did was they passed laws and they changed the standard of review and the standards of proof on many of the civil rights laws to make them more favorable to plaintiffs. And they were upheld by the court. But that's the type of response. That's what you do when you don't like an interpretation of a statute. And that is one where it's very clear that they disagreed with how the court had interpreted existing statutes, which I thought were correct decisions, by the way, at the time. But they changed the law so it would be more in line with what they thought of the world. And they got what they wanted. And that's how you're supposed to do it. I don't think you're supposed to pack the court or try and say that anything they do is illegitimate, particularly when on the progressive interpretation of the Constitution, your idea is that the court should be going with applying modern conditions to whatever the constitutional principle is rather than the constitutional words. Because what you're doing there's a level of abstraction that to the neutral observer may not be as clear as it is if you're already in the progressive fold. And so I think what's happening here, and I think I'd love for someone like Thomas to explain, is that there's a conflict of visions, to quote Thomas Sowell. One's constrained and one's unconstrained. And they come out with different views on every issue in the way that Thomas Sowell describes in that great book. But because that's happening, and because I think the justices represent intellectual positions in the legal world more than they used to represent oftentimes sections, the South, the West, the New England. So they used to be more sectional, but now they are very much more, what does the Constitution mean? How does the Declaration of Independence inform it? What is our duty vis-a-vis the legislature? What does the legislature get to do? What do we get to do? And those issues are what's driving them, and not whether an R or D wants this legislation to be upheld or struck down.
Well, you know, I think it's interesting that there's only one justice on the Supreme Court who's from west of the Mississippi. And if people think that that doesn't matter, they're wrong. And I don't, the Constitution doesn't create regional chairs for the, or seats for the justices, but the concentration of Boston to Washington axis justices that we've had, particularly over the last 30 to 40 years, means that we've had a court that has been, I think, politically in a different place from the populace as a whole. And if you have that for a long period of time, and then you have a little bit of the court switching back to something that's a closer reflection of the court, or excuse me, of the society as a whole, it shouldn't be shocking that you might see some different outcomes. And I think that can be true even if the justices aren't politically motivated. I'm not trying to suggest that the current court is politically motivated.
Mark, one thing that's easy to see is that Gorsuch has much more touch feel for Indian rights than other folks. And right. Why is that? Where are there large groups of Indians with large groups of land? You know, it's not in Connecticut, you know?
Yeah.
And so he's much more familiar and much more, I'd say, open to those arguments than I think he would if he wasn't a man of the West. But
he served on the 10th Circuit, where those cases came up in the 10th Circuit. And correct. We have so many justices who served on the D.C. Circuit where those issues never come up. So it's a difference.
It's exactly. It changes. But I do want to say there is one man of the West from California, Erwin Chemerinsky, who, for our listeners who don't know, he is a famous law professor and dean and academic. He's written textbooks, and he was highly thought of for a very long time. But he came out with
in certain circles.
But you know, if you're in textbooks at Berkeley and other places where they're teaching law, I mean,
I'm sure his textbook was widely used in law schools across America. That's for sure.
And so he has declared that at least the conservatives on the court are all partisan hacks. Law school dean criticizes SCOTUS justices appointed by Republicans. It's in the news. So he is from the West, but I do not think you'd get a lot of nuanced, different positions if Dean Chemerinsky was put on the Supreme Court in order to strike some balance.
I also don't think that anybody from the West considers Berkeley, California to be part of the West. I mean, you're talking about bi-coastal elites when you talk about someone like Chemerinsky. That's not the same thing as somebody who's from a state like Colorado, like Gorsuch is, who has much more of a Western focus. So, yeah, I take your point, but I wouldn't consider Chemerinsky a man of the West.
So, but this is something that I think we're going to be returning to, because we are going to discuss some, the Supreme Court is going to start again the first Monday in October, and we'll be discussing some of the cases that are being argued there, and we'll discuss some today. But I think that on all the justices' mind, this idea that politics will be intruding, and I've just got a little vignette that tells you about where I'm deeply in Washington. And last night I was at a house where where Chief Justice Marshall and Chief Justice Story lived during their lives.
That's
and there
neat.
was a and there was a dinner there, and I met Tim Corcoran, who is the son of Tommy the Cork Corcoran, who was Franklin Roosevelt's guy on court packing. So we had a wonderful discussion about that, and he was of the view that his father didn't get on the Supreme Court because of that, and didn't become a judge, and he became a famous man and had tremendous political power here, and there's like a million stories about him. But I found that interesting, the way that I just ran into this living legacy of this.
And is the Corcoran Art Gallery named after him?
And I don't think so. I think it's someone else, but I could be wrong. I didn't ask Mr. Corcoran that. I should. Next time I see him, I will ask him. But he had a fascinating legal career in his own right.
Did Tommy the Cork have a position on prohibition?
Again. So
just checking.
Although I think the nickname was because he was quick to anger and would pop off. That's what I think the nickname came from. But if you read anything about the Roosevelt or the Truman or the LBJ, you'll see him appearing in the pageant of history. But since we talk about court packing all the time, I was like, oh my God, I can't believe it.
I've got to introduce you to my friend Mark.
Exactly. So anyways, but we should look at the justices are concerned about this. They do not want to be seen as political, but on the other hand, they have to do write opinions of what they actually believe the law says. And that goes for all of them. It's not just the Republican appointees, that they all have to do what they think the law requires and the Constitution requires, and let the chips fall where they may.
Well, if they fail to do that, that's political too.
It is. Correct. Welcome back to Administrative Static. And as I have said, the Supreme Court term is rushing up towards us. And there's a number of politically contentious cases. And these are cases over rights that are in the Constitution or not in the Constitution, as your views dictate, let's say. But one of these is the Second Amendment. And the Second Amendment is the right to bear arms, that the right to bear arms shall not be abridged. A well-regulated militia being necessary for the safety of a free state, you know, this whole thing. And what's interesting about that is that for most of my legal life, the Second Amendment has been practically a dead letter, practically a dead letter. You didn't see cases on it in the Supreme Court. You were very unlikely to strike down any prohibitions on the ownership of firearms or the use of firearms. And everything that happened, particularly in the 60s with the riots and the assassinations, there was a lot of regulation of guns after that. Prior to that, there hadn't been that much, really. New York had some, But by and large, all this gun regulation came up with not a peep from the Supreme Court forever and ever. And then finally, a case came up. Our friend Alan Gura brought Heller up there. And the Supreme Court said, yeah, the Second Amendment exists. It's a thing. it's in the Constitution. And now we finally, after 200 years, have to do something about it. And so they started with that one case to say, look, you are allowed to own a gun in your home. That's what it stands for. And they then extended that right a couple of years later to against the states. The states couldn't take it away either. Heller was the District of Columbia, so the federal government couldn't do it. That was the first thing. Then it was whether the states could. And so we know those two things, that you can have a gun in your home.
McDonald case, I believe.
The McDonald case, correct. So we now know you can have a gun in your home. But many states that are against Second Amendment rights and believe guns should be heavily, heavily regulated, New York, California, you know who they are. They have been making it burdensome to carry your gun around. And so you can't have open carry like we have in Virginia, it might have just changed, but you could have a gun on your holster. You could have a pistol on your holster or carry your rifle around. Now localities can stop it and things like this recently. But the fact is, so there's open carry, but then there's the one that has always bothered the police, I think, more, which is concealed carry. So it's been very common that you could get a concealed carry permit. In most places, you go in, you show you have good character, you haven't been convicted of anything, you don't have any domestic abuse charges against you, none of that stuff. And you can get a concealed carry permit where you can wear a gun under your coat or under your jacket or otherwise. Well, New York State has put in a law where your local police, the local police chief of your jurisdiction has to give you a permit. And you have to show him good reason why you need it. Why do you need to have concealed carry? Now, you can't have open carry in New York, mind you. So what they're saying is you can't have concealed carry and you can't have open carry. So how you get your gun to the range, other than putting it in a box in the trunk, I have no idea. And I don't even know if that's allowed. That was teed up last year, but New York repealed the law and made it moot. that said you couldn't carry it around to your shooting range. But New York is at it again.
And the justices were divided over whether that made it moot or not, didn't they? Wasn't there a bit of controversy about that?
There was controversy. They were all, I don't know that they were divided. What they said was, I don't like this. I don't like the way you're doing this, making it moot, because this is going to come back here. And I think one of them one or two said, wait a second, you can't moot it this way. But I think other words, yeah, I guess you can, but don't do this. We don't like you doing this after we've granted cert, because that was really what bugged it.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's New York State Rifle and Pistol Association who's brought these other cases v. Bruin. And the question is whether the state's denial of petitioners' applications for concealed carry licenses for self-defense violated the Second Amendment. And it's being argued by Kirkland & Ellis's Paul Clement, who is no stranger to the Supreme Court. And on the New York side, it's New York Solicitor General Barbara Underwood, who's been in New York legal circles for a very long time. And a Georgetown graduate, I think, 1969. But in any event, they are going to be up there. And the amicus briefs, meaning the friends of the court briefs on this case, are incredible. Other states are weighing in. Certain of the racial minority defense bars in New York have put in an amicus brief saying, look, we can have clients who are clean as a whistle, have never had anything happen. They're black or Hispanic or something like this. And they're in a dangerous neighborhood and they have to walk to and from work at night. And they cannot have a gun because the police will not allow them to have a gun. And then if they go and get a gun because they're being menaced all the time, they then become criminals and they're getting all these harsh sentences. It's extremely unfair. And this is why the Second Amendment has to be enforced. On the other hand, the ACLU has put in an amicus brief. Now, the American Civil Liberties Union has put in an amicus brief that the Second Amendment doesn't give you the civil liberty of actually bearing arms, like it says. So this is, they have put in a brief that I couldn't believe it, Mark. It says that.
You could.
Yeah.
The ACLU stopped believing in the civil liberties part of their name a long time ago.
So they have anecdotes of where
that's why the new Civil Liberties Alliance exists.
Exactly. Why they've got anecdotes of all these people with concealed carry permits who wave them at protesters in Black Lives Matter or some other cause related things. They say that the Second Amendment is being used to silence the First Amendment by these people.
And yes, so, like that menacing couple on the steps of their own home in St. Louis.
Exactly. You got it. So they're chilling First Amendment rights. And that's why the Second Amendment has to be chilled by the state of New York.
I remember how everybody saw them and then refrained from carrying on to the mayor's house for the protest. Oh, no, wait, that's not how that happened. They they just walked right by. I never mind.
Exactly. So I think that the amicus briefs are coming out of the woodwork, and they're from all different angles. And I think a lot of them are aimed at Justice Sotomayor. They're aimed at her because you would think that she would, because really what's going on here, I guess I should tell our listeners is that the two decisions, Heller and McDonald, Thomas has complained that the court won't take any Second Amendment cases so that nobody knows what it means. And he says it's like a second class amendment, second class right. So he's been agitating on this point.
Well, yeah, because all the states and localities have been putting up all kinds of really severe restrictions that make a mockery of the idea that this is a constitutional right.
Yes, well, that's the argument in any event. And so he says that's our job to figure those things out. And because all we know now is you're allowed to keep a gun in your home for self-defense. That is bearing arms. Now, I don't believe that's what bearing arms meant in the colonial period or the revolutionary period or the constitutional period. But and I don't think Thomas does either. And I think that's what he's getting at. But non-originalists like Sonia Sotomayor, what does she care about? She cares about over-criminalization, particularly amongst minority communities who do not have the political power that, you know, if your name is Cuomo and you go to the chief of police in New York and you say you need a concealed carry permit because the Me Too people are after you, they give you one, right? thank you, Matt. Thank you, Andrew. Here's your concealed carry permit. But if your name is not Cuomo and you go there and you're from a poor neighborhood and you're not a connected person, you don't get concealed carry. So, I mean, there's even an equal protection angle to this, because why are some, you know, big stars? I think some of those, you know, Eastern Long Island and Montauk and Nassau, you know, all the people out in the rich areas of Long Island are getting these concealed carries. Yeah, the Hamptons, they're all getting it. And then people who are actually where they might actually get shot rather than, you know, accidentally hit by a Mercedes are not getting it. So I think there is a big problem there, just on the, you know, if there's a constitutional right, it's a constitutional right for everyone. And this law really, by giving so much discretion to police officers, it has problems. And so it's going to be argued, and I have not checked how many arguments before the Supreme Court Ms. Underwood's done. But we know that Paul Clement's going to bring the fire. He very rarely puts a foot wrong, in my experience, anyway. So I think that the New York Rifle and Pistol Association certainly has somebody who the court is very familiar with. And I think he's going to also...
Talented advocate.
Right. And he's going to be aiming at Sotomayor, I think. And the one I'm interested in seeing, Mark, is Alito. What does Alito think about the Second Amendment? He's been kind of quiet about it.
Well, he voted in both Heller and McDonald. So, I mean,
true. The Second Amendment. That's true. Yeah. But where the outer bounds of it are, I would watch Alito. I would watch him a little bit because he is a law enforcement guy.
Yeah, I'm not worried. I think Barrett will be interesting. We can see what happens with her.
That's true.
And frankly, Kavanaugh. I think Kavanaugh is an unknown on this subject.
No, big Second Amendment guy. Yeah, he's written an opinion, I think, already on it. No, I'm positive of him. I know where he's going. So the thing is, what we will see in this big case, we've seen a lot of strange bedfellows on the amicuses, and let's see whether they get a consensus or if this contentious case splits down the left-right axis. We'll be back in a minute.